Good morning. Today we will discuss some important igneous rock types. To begin with, you all know that igneous rocks derived this term from ignis. In Latin it means fire. Are formed, means these are igneous rocks, you all know they are formed from your magma or lava through cooling and solidification. Igneous rocks may form with or without crystallization either below the surface as intrusive, that is the plutonic rocks, or on the surface as extrusive volcanic rocks. Now the significance, you can say the geological significance of these igneous rocks. The first is their minerals and global chemistry. The mineral composition in igneous rocks and then global chemistry give information about composition of the earth as such. Because you all know that in the crust 95% are your igneous rocks. Then these sedimentary rocks, they form only thin veneer. They have depth up to, you say, an average 4 kilometers. And they are only in 4.5% taking metamorphic at the equivalents. So the bulk composition of the crust is of the igneous rocks. 95% crust by volume consists of your igneous rocks. So their mineral chemistry helps in understanding the composition of the crust. Then the second significance of igneous rocks is that the absolute ages can be derived by radiometric dating, because the radioactive elements which are present in the igneous rocks, from that we can date and we can know the ages of the rocks. Third is their features are characteristic of tectonic environments, allowing tectonic reconstruction. That is very important part. The modern days, now it is, everything is talking, is being talked in terms of the tectonic setting and what type different igneous rocks are found in different tectonic settings, that helps in reconstruction of the tectonic environment. Then some of the host rocks, these igneous rocks, they are host for your economic minerals. For example, you all know that diamonds, they are found in the kimberlite. That kimberlite is again your ultramafic rock, and diamonds are found in granites, radioactive minerals are found, this cassiterite is found in granitic rocks, and there are number of in vesicle basalt, in vesicles the copper has been found. Likewise, the number of these means they are the host for the economic minerals. So these are the significance of the igneous rocks. And if you talk the volcanic or extrusive rocks erupted annually in the volcano, in the volcanoes with plate setting, divergent boundaries it is 73% and convergent boundary 15% and 12% in the hot spots. Now if you talk of your crust as such, you all know that the most abundant element is the oxygen, then is your silicon, then it is aluminium, then iron, then calcium, sodium, potassium, magnesium. So out of the known elements in the earth crust, the known elements are around 113 or so. Out of these, the 10 elements, they constitute 99% bulk composition of the crust. And it is now statistically proven that the main minerals that are present in the crust, the main, you can say, silicate group is your feldspars. Feldspars are present in more than 55% composition in the crust. So if you, because the composition of the elements is reflected in minerals and the composition of minerals is reflected in rocks, so it is in very essential, or it is the most primary important to study the igneous rocks. And from this, if you want to know further the detailed model composition of the mineral composition, feldspars, they are present exactly in 59.5%, and quartz is around 22%. These your olivine, pyroxene, amphibole together, they are 16.8%, biotite 3.8%. So likewise, we can understand the major composition is of your feldspars. Now coming to important rock types, naturally once the feldspars, they are important composition. If we can broadly discuss the rocks in that, in terms of your, there's first let us take the category of your ultramafic rocks. We all know that ultramafic rocks are those which have mafic minerals more than 90%. If any rock having more than 90% essential mineral as mafic, it is known as ultramafic rock. Right, for example, your dunite, rhodotite, pyroxenite, kimberlite, so such rocks are in the category of ultramafic. Naturally, once these mafic minerals are in large amount, the silica content is less, so they are also ultra basic. So all ultramafic rocks are ultra basic, but that when we say all ultra basic, they are not ultramafic. For example, your nepheline syenite. In nepheline syenite, there is no mafic mineral, but it is ultra basic. Means it is ultra basic is a term used with reference to your silica content. If your rock is having less than 45% silica, it is known as ultra basic. Incidentally, all ultramafic rocks, they have silica content less than 45%. Hence, they are ultramafic as well as ultra basic. But vice versa is not true. All ultra basic rocks are not ultramafic. Example, I have given nepheline syenite. Nepheline syenite is ultra basic, but it is not ultramafic because it doesn't contain as mafic mineral as a sustained mineral. Right, so basic rocks, this next category broadly we can say the basic rocks. Basic rocks means which have silica content from 45 to 52%. Such rocks are known as basic rocks. And examples, you can gabbro, norite, anorthosite, troctolite, dolerite, basalt, and related rocks. So these rocks are your basic rocks, and then the intermediate rocks. On the basis of silica content, intermediate rocks are those which have silica content from 50 to 66%. And the rock names, diorite, monzonite, syenite, andesite, these such rocks are your intermediate igneous rocks. And the fourth, on the basis of silica content, they are the acid or the igneous rocks. Means rocks having silica content more than 66%, they are known as acid or silicic igneous rocks. And examples, common your granite, syenite, granodiorite, tonalite, rhyolite, and related rocks. So this is the broadly, we have just, you can say, the framework of the different igneous rocks. Now, taking some common, your igneous rocks, as such, which are common and are used, the first and the foremost of your rock is granite. You all know granite is a plutonic rock. And just I said, it is an acid igneous rocks, means it has silica percent more than 66%. So this rock as mineral composition bears quartz and orthoclase essential mineral. Some mafic minerals may be present as accessory, like biotite, muscovite. And in some alkali, you can say granites, we can have even your alkali amphiboles and pyroxenes. So granite is plutonic rock having mineral composition quartz and orthoclase. The texture of granite, it is a plutonic, it has coarse to medium grain size, and under microscope we can observe even the graphic texture. Graphic is quartz, is the intergrowth of quartz and orthoclase. The volcanic equivalent of granite is your rhyolite. So these are the first two names that student of pathology should start learning. Granite is a plutonic rock and its volcanic equivalent is a rhyolite. Now next is your gabbro. It's a common rock, gabbro, again plutonic rock having mineral composition as labradorite plus your pyroxenes. Now if pyroxene is in clinopyroxene, a rock is having your labradorite as one essential mineral, the other is your clinopyroxene, the name of the rock will be your gabbro. But if it has orthopyroxene, means labradorite plus orthopyroxene, then it will be known as norite. So there is only minor in the difference in the nature of the pyroxene. As such, they are in the category of, you I just said, in the basic rocks. The volcanic equivalent of gabbro is your basalt. The very, you can say, common rock found in seafloor spreading, and the most common volcanic rock, this is basalt, this is the volcanic equivalent of your gabbro. Once again I remind you that rocks are named on the basis of texture and mineral composition. And a rock is named on the basis of texture and mineral composition. What we have just observed, that gabbro, there is the texture of gabbro and norite is same, but mineralogical they are different, hence the names of the rocks are different. Similarly, we can see that gabbro and basalt, though they have same mineral composition, but texturally they are different. Gabbro being plutonic, it is coarse grained, whereas basalt being volcanic, it is fine grained. So you should keep in mind that a rock is named on the basis of the texture and mineral composition. Then another important common igneous rock is your nepheline syenite. Nepheline syenite, it is you comes in the category of your ultra basic rocks, just I told, and the mineral composition is your nepheline plus orthoclase. Nepheline, you all know, is a member of the feldspathoid group, and orthoclase member of the feldspar group. So as such, we can keep this rock in the alkaline rocks category also. The very rare occurrence of nepheline syenite are found, and the volcanic equivalent of nepheline syenite is your phonolite. The phonolite, naturally they are texturally different, but as far as mineral composition is concerned, this your nepheline syenite and phonolite, they have same different texture but same mineral composition. Now another very common rock name you must have come across, that is the pegmatites. Now pegmatites, they are also known as the museum of minerals. Pegmatites, they are extremely coarse grained, they crystallize in the end stages of the magma and bears, just as I said, is a museum of minerals, bears number of minerals like your, in addition to quartz and orthoclase, that is feldspars, they have extreme grain size. The remaining residual minerals which are left in magma, they also crystallize, and like tourmaline, mica, fluorite, beryl, cassiterite, such minerals which are of economic importance, they are also very well found in the pegmatites. These common names you must coming across, these are another name, say obsidian. Once we say obsidian, obsidian is a black or dark colored, essentially non-vesicular volcanic glass, usually of rhyolitic composition. Then the tuff. Tuff is compacted deposit of volcanic ash. The tuff is the compacted deposit of volcanic ash and dust containing up to 50% sedimentary material even. The related name, breccia. Do you know breccia are of three types? Volcanic breccia, tectonic breccia and sedimentary breccia. Right now we are talking of this, the volcanic breccia. It is similar to tuff, but containing larger angular fragments. Larger angular fragments, more than 2 mm and finer matrix. And then another very interesting rock name, pumice. You know, pumice is a frothy, glassy glass, you can say, generally having very low specific gravity, even less than water, and that's why it floats in water, right? The pumice, because it has number of your, say, the voids in it, and it's a glassy frothy. Then the name peridotite, coming to the ultramafic rocks, peridotite, general term for a rock containing 40 to 100% olivine with remainder mainly pyroxene and hornblende. Means 40 to 100% is the olivine range, and the remainder counterpart is of your pyroxenes and hornblende. Similarly, dunite, we can say a rock containing more than 90% olivine, or in other words, we can say peridotite containing 90 to 100% olivine is your dunite. Similarly, pyroxenite, as the name speaks, pyroxenite again is a plutonic rock, and it is, as it says, pyroxenite means it contains more than 90%. Pyroxene essential mineral. Now the volcanic equivalent of ultramafic rocks is a very rare rock, that is your cometite, right? Cometite is considered extraterrestrial material or rock, but it is debatable. You take for granted, once there is a question, it is in a volcanic equivalent of peridotite, that it has the specific texture, you must be aware of it. Similarly, a rock kimberlite, it is an altered porphyritic mica peridotite containing olivine, commonly converted to serpentine and serpentine and phlogophyte is also present, and you all know it is the host for your diamonds. So it is, you can say, a variety of peridotite, right? This kimberlite and is a host for the diamonds. In South Africa, diamonds are found in that kimberlite rock. So these are a few common rocks. In addition to these, the other names you must have, these carbonatites. These carbonatites is only few years back it was considered as an igneous rock. As the name says, carbonatites, it is a magmatic rock composed chiefly of carbonates of calcium, magnesium and sodium with subordinate feldspars and feldspathoids. Carbonatites are found with nepheline rich rocks such as you can say the various carbonate minerals are of the calcite, dolomite, anchorite. And naturally, once carbonate, they are dominating the silica content. On that basis, if you say they are the encompassing the category of ultra basic rocks. Then another rock names, that's lamprophyres. Lamprophyres, you can say it is a group of mafic dikes, means they are the hyperbasal rocks, commonly having that this is your extra, it is a, once you say it is strongly porphyritic. And the term that for the texture that is used, it is porphyritic with euhedral crystals, euhedral mafic minerals, right? That term that is used for the peridiomorphic texture means if a rock has euhedral crystals, so and the grains are of same size, then that is known as a peridiomorphic. So lamprophyres, that way it has peridiomorphic. Then another rock name, that is the anorthosite. Anorthosite is a plutonic rock composed of more than 90% or greater than 90% plagioclase feldspars with dominantly labradorite along with andesite and your biotonite. So likewise, the different rock names, they are developed. I have just given few important, distinguished, or you say the kindred types of different igneous rocks. So you can pick up and try start remembering the names of your different igneous rocks and make in a habit, once you just come across a name of a plutonic rock, you try to find its volcanic equivalent. Similarly, if you come across volcanic rock, try to find its your plutonic equivalent. So your list of these rock names will be enhanced and you will understand the igneous petrology in a better way. So this is all for today. We will take on next time few other names or few other categories of igneous rocks. Thank you very much. Thank you. Have a good day. Bye.